Hello, everyone. This series has been about how organisms develop genetic and phenotypic modifications, how those modifications proliferate throughout populations, and how populations change as a whole over time. However, we haven't yet seen what happens when a species disappears, or how that impacts other species. So, let's jump right in. Extinction is the termination of a clade of organisms of at least one species, and it has been estimated that over 99% of species that have ever existed are now extinct. The extinction of a species can be caused by a number of factors: lack of resources, climate change, diseases, competition with other species, or the occasional fireball of death and destruction, and more. Isn't nature great? Every living thing has to find a way to extract resources from the environment in order to survive and eventually reproduce. The description of how a specific organism, or species, goes about their daily lives in order to achieve this goal is called an ecological niche. In retrospect, this can be viewed as the ecological role that a species occupies within an ecosystem. The general evolutionary principle that explains how niches are filled by species is the competitive exclusion principle, which says that the coexistence of two or more species competing with each other for the same resources is unstable. Unless there are other factors at play, eventually the one species with the advantage will outcompete the others. This drives the other species to either move to a new area free of competition, or it evolves to shift towards a different niche. Otherwise, it will face extinction. So no, evolution is not all about getting bigger, better, and stronger to successfully compete with and eliminate the weak. Avoiding competition is more often a better survival strategy. Just another example of creationists getting something completely backwards about evolution. There are several ways how a species might respond to the competitive exclusion principle. A species might specialize into a very narrow food source that no other species can use, like koalas, which only eat eucalyptus that is toxic to everything else. Or one might generalize, like the raccoons, which eat pretty much anything they can. Another way is that a species might even evolve to a niche on another trophic level, from being carnivorous to herbivorous, like the giant panda, or going from herbivory to carnivory, like Thylacoleo, the marsupial lion. Although a more subtle way to avoid competition is niche differentiation, where species use the same environment slightly differently such that it allows them to coexist. A great example of this are the anole lizards of the Caribbean islands. They mainly feed on the same food source, insects, however they avoid competition by occupying different physical elevations from the jungle floor all the way to the top of the forest canopy. Species of different islands that live on the same elevation level were superficially more similar to each other than to species living on other elevations. But surprisingly, each island is inhabited by lizards that are more closely related to each other than to species of different islands. This means that this niche differentiation process happened multiple times independently, leading to convergent evolution. To see the full story, BioInteractive did a great video on this called The Phylogenetic Tree of Anole Lizards, link in the description. Living things within an ecosystem form a complex food web consisting of different trophic levels. At the bottom are the producers, like plants, that convert abiogenic sources of energy into organic matter, which can be consumed by organisms on higher trophic levels. The herbivores and omnivores in turn can be consumed by carnivores and, again, omnivores. Organic matter that is not consumed is converted by decomposers into nutrients, which are then used by the producers, completing the circle of life, pun intended. Species that are part of the same food web are therefore interdependent to each other in varying degrees. Thus, when extinction happens, this can have various effects on the ecosystem as a whole. If, for instance, there are five species in one area that all fulfill about the same ecological roles, and if no other species, such as predators, are entirely dependent on only one species, then one of them going extinct might not have a large effect on the other populations. However, if a species that has a huge impact on the environment, called a keystone species, goes extinct, then the other populations will likely be affected drastically. When one species goes extinct as a result of the extinction of another, It is known as co-extinction, and it leads to an ecological cascade effect, where the extinction of one species leads to a series of extinctions. An example of a keystone species is the otter, who hangs out in underwater kelp forests. Otters eat sea urchins, who in turn eat the holdfasts that keep kelp anchored. If the otters were removed, the urchins would be able to eat the holdfasts much more easily, hindering the growth of the kelp. Mass extinction happens when a great environmental disturbance disrupts the energy flow of organic matter within a food web. This often happens when the primary producers are severely affected, resulting in the collapse of the ecosystem. Also, please remember that the specialized species tend to go extinct more easily than generalists under drastic environmental changes because specialists are more dependent on the existence of other species. This shows that it isn't just about the survival of the fittest. Also, specialists include apex predators like us, which is another reason to think that causing environmental degradation on a global scale is probably not a very good idea. The competitive exclusion principle can only drive species to occupy different niches as long as there are still niches left to fill. This is why when extinctions happen, new species tend to evolve more often. And the greater the extinction event, the greater the adaptive radiation that follows to fill in all those vacant niches. This echoes another great, but not widely known, idea of Niles Eldridge called the sloshing bucket. As he describes, quote, "Hence the sloshing bucket. Nothing much happens in terms of discernible morphological evolution until environmental change overturns the ecological apple cart. A little degradation, including the deaths of individuals, will not lead to measurable evolutionary change. A huge amount of devastation, on the other hand, can lead to the extinction of entire major groups, prompting the evolution of other large-scale groups. And on intermediate spatio-temporal scales, where individual species are driven to extinction, but not higher taxa, new species evolve, populating the new ecosystems. The greater the magnitude of the environmental event, the greater the change in ecosystems, including the magnitude of diversity lost through extinction. The greater the loss of higher taxa, the more different will be the newly evolved taxa, and thus the nature of the succeeding ecosystems that replaced the prior disturbed systems. It is like water sloshing in the bucket, the size of the slosh is depending on how hard the bucket is jolted." Close quote. The following are some of these bucket sloshes that happened in Earth's history. There was a minor extinction event that occurred in Euramerica about 305 million years ago called the Carboniferous Rainforest Collapse. This extinction event is proposed to have been caused by a combination of volcanism and climate change, causing the continent to become cooler and drier. It was devastating to amphibians, but the more adaptable amniotes profited from it, undergoing an adaptive radiation in the following Permian period. This resulted in large anapsids and synapsids and some diapsids, however their heyday was yet to come. When the Permian-Triassic extinction event occurred some 250 million years ago, the large anapsids and synapsids were wiped out, allowing the diapsids to take over. This event was evidently caused by a combination of an extreme greenhouse effect with increased volcanism and even a possible bolide impact. One group of diapsids known as the archosauromorphs became especially prominent following the event, radiating into a number of groups including the tenistrophiids, alocotosaurs, rhynchosaurs, prolacertids, pseudosuchians, who we talked about in the video Stasis, pterosaurs, and eventually dinosaurs. Dinosaurs then underwent their own series of radiations after the demise of many competing archosauromorph lineages at the end of the Triassic. This extinction event seems to have been caused by major eruptions from the Central Atlantic magmatic province. There were other minor extinction events that occurred during the reign of the dinosaurs, such as the Middle Cretaceous extinction event that displaced Carcharodontosaurids as the apex predators in North America and Asia, and allowed the Tyrannosaurs to become dominant. But dinosaurs themselves did not experience a mass extinction until the end Cretaceous. Among other things, a bolide smashed into Earth, eradicating the dinosaurs and various other Mesozoic critters. Then, the mammals ascended and filled the niches the dinosaurs left vacant. In the Cenozoic, large carnivores like mesonicids, carnivorous hooved mammals, went extinct and their niche was filled by dogs, cats, and bears. And so the cycle continues. As you can see, extinctions can cause macroevolutionary events by giving organisms the opportunity to invade previously filled niches. Thus, we have seen in this series that genetic differences appear in populations, Those populations are acted upon by forces such as natural selection and genetic drift, and new species arise. Then those species interact with their environments and other organisms therein, contributing to the vast amount of biological diversity on our planet. So, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.